Hi, everybody, and thank you for tuning in. And this is Rory, and I'm one of the contributors for SGT Report. And I also have a YouTube channel, the Daily Coin. And I have on the line today a gentleman from Ukraine. He's an American citizen, but he is currently living in Ukraine, and he's outside of Kiev. But I'll let him get more into that. His name is Roman. And Roman, give me your last name because I don't want to butcher it.
It's Skaskio.
Skaskio.
Yep.
And he's going to give us some insight to what's actually happening in Ukraine with the protests, with the riots, with a firsthand account of what's actually happening there. And Roman, thank you so much for taking some time out today. And if you would, just briefly introduce yourself to the audience, give them your website, your YouTube channel, and what you're doing in Ukraine.
Well, my pleasure. Thank you for having me. My name is Roman. I was born and raised in the United States. I last lived in Iowa. Here's my T-shirt from the 2012 straw poll in Iowa, where I turned out in support of Ron Paul. A couple years ago, I made the move to Ukraine, and I'm developing software and writing. I was in the American military. I was an infantry officer for about 6 years, and I'm writing a book about Afghanistan. I've written about my military experiences for Mises.org, Daily Anarchist, and a few other sources. Right now, I'm blogging pretty aggressively about the protests in Ukraine. My website is romaninukraine.com. I also have a YouTube channel which has mostly libertarian book reviews. It's called Roman's Book Report.
Thank you. And I just want to jump right in and find out exactly what's going on. And if you prefer, Roman, not giving the name of the city where you're located, I understand. But if you would please, let people know approximately how close to Kiev you are. And what is the infrastructure like? Is there food coming in? Is there water, electricity, all in operating order? And what is daily life like where you're located?
Sure. Well, I don't mind sharing it. I'm in the western city of Lviv, Ukraine. It's kind of the sort of spiritual home of the protests. Most of the energy is coming from the western part of the country. It's about 300 miles from Kiev. And despite all the fire and mayhem that is making the headlines, the infrastructure is fine. It's fine here in Lviv, and it's fine in Kiev. Restaurants, businesses continue to operate. I'm not sure how the businesses look right where the fighting is happening, but I can tell you that when I visited the Maidan about a week and a half ago, like, I was amazed to see that even within the perimeter of the camp, I should add, the camp occupies the single most expensive piece of real estate in all of Ukraine, a street called Khrushchatyk, the christening. So there's all these, like, high-end retail shops, selling the latest clothes and everything else. And amazingly, they all continue to function. The big barricades had gaps in them, and customers and employees walk through these gaps in the barricades, and it was a little bit surreal. It was just this normal old city life happening right alongside these protests. Now, I'm not sure how it looks now that it got violent, but as of a week and a half ago, there had already been, I think, 6 deaths, and there had already been some fighting, but yet, you know, the shops were working, nothing was smashed or looted, so it's not as bad as it looks on TV, at least not in terms of normal life.
Okay, thank you. And that's exactly what kind of information that we need, because all the images that we see are just, you know, carnage and,
right,
you know, Molotov cocktails flying through the air and so forth. But we know that there's something behind that. And
yes.
So as far as getting a good picture of that, that's what I'm looking for, to see what's going on. And it's interesting that these guys have decided to occupy the most expensive property in Ukraine. You know, might as well be in a good neighborhood.
Yeah, that's the city center, and that's like it's the center of Kiev. Like the way the streets are organized, it's very much the epicenter of the city.
Okay.
So it's always been the place for protests, big and small.
And we're hearing here that, you know, Soros is sponsoring some of the protesters. And what is the reality of the protesters? Who are they and where are they coming from? And what is the motivation?
Right. Well, I guess I'm reacting to what I'm going to say is a kind of a reaction to what I feel has been overreporting about Western influence. I have no illusions whatsoever that the Western intelligence agencies are here. Soros is known to support Femen. That's this radical feminist group that always shows their boobs and protests about things. And when these protests kicked off, Femen made an appearance that was very embarrassing. A bunch of naked ladies walked out with pictures of the president. But I saw that as Femen trying to stay relevant. So I believe, I don't have a shred of doubt in my mind that these protests are homegrown and that the West is very actively trying to co-opt them and influence the outcome. But these protests are not created by the West. They're homegrown. And let me offer a little historical context to support this view. In 1945, when all the armies, you know, all the British and American soldiers, they all went home and celebrated victory, the fighting continued in Ukraine for 10 years. It was only in 1955 that armed resistance to the Soviet Union ended. Armed resistance by Ukrainians to the Soviet Union ended. So it kept going for 10 years. You know, obviously, that wasn't supported by the West. The West was given all kinds of support to Stalin at the time. The media was calling him Uncle Joe. So given that historical context, you know, I don't think it's so hard to see that the children and grandchildren of those partisans are now, you know, motivating themselves to fight what they regard as the kleptocracy, as the criminal regime that succeeded the Soviet Union, and that's kind of held up by the former KGB agent turned Russian president Putin. I also have personal contacts among the protesters. For example, I develop software. My lead software developer, who's a super talented programmer, he has an SUV, he has a three-story house, he has a wife and two kids. We go skiing together. He's part of Ukraine's tiny middle class. You know, as soon as any violence flares up in Kiev, I lose him because he goes there. At this latest violence, I sent him an SMS. I said, is it time to wish you a safe journey again or something like that? And he texted me back, too late, I'm already in Maidan. So he covered those 300 miles like it was nothing.
Wow.
So I don't doubt what, for example, Paul Craig Roberts wrote, that there's Western intelligence here paying protesters $30 a day to attend a protest. But there's a lot of people like my lead software developer who is not motivated by $30 a day. So it's both. Both things are true. I think it's overreported, though.
Okay. And now you had sent me a video earlier, a link to a video earlier today regarding paid protesters, not paid protesters, but the Russian thugs is the way you dubbed it. And they had attacked a journalist who was just trying to, what appeared to be, reporting on the situation. And it was in Russian, and unfortunately I don't speak Russian, so I really didn't get the gist of what the cameraman, the journalist, and the person that he was speaking with, I didn't understand what they were talking about, but it seemed to be a very civil conversation just regarding their surroundings and what was actually going on. And then the next thing you know, they're being attacked by this group of what, once again, seemingly just regular people, but turns out they were actually marauders. it was pretty vicious from what little bit of the attack was shown in the video. Can you speak to that, please?
So that's a new vocabulary word, tetushka. And I just actually found out only today, after using that word for a few months, it's named after a single person, Vadim Tatushka, who was just a hired thug by the government. And now all the hired thugs from the government are called Tatushka. So that poor guy, he has his, you know, his last name is you know, forever scorned. But it's been a very common practice to hire, usually it's coal miners from the Russian-speaking east part of the country, to just come and either do counter protests or to beat the protesters. And there's some pretty brutal videos of the Tatushka working side by side with the police and just beating the living crap out of protesters. In, I think it was early January, 300 Tatushka went out and surrounded the US embassy in Kiev. And there's raw footage which I posted on my website, Roman in Ukraine, of them complaining amongst each other that they didn't get paid their, I forget whether it was 200 or 300 hryvnias to do that, what they're doing, to come and surround the U.S. embassy. It's kind of a menacing moment, but it sort of dissipated without ever coming to any violence. So the video I posted was those Tatushka. It was an interview with some Tatushka. And the Russian-speaking reporter was kind of giving them support, like you guys are heroes. Tell me about yourself. Where are you from? You know, tell me about what you're doing. And he's walking with this one Tatushka named Topaz. And then he goes to Topaz's friends and, like, just keeps asking these questions, like, come on, talk, because Topaz was very, like, standoffish. And his friends, I guess, just didn't like the fact that he was filming and just started beating him. And the last thing you hear is the reporter crying, you know, screaming, Topaz, Topaz, ask him to stop, ask him to stop.
Wow.
So, so that was pretty dramatic. And what I've discovered since sending you that video, another video emerged that Topaz, this is a little frightening, he's in the custody of the protesters now. And they took a little short video of Topaz saying, why did you come here? And he says, I came here to support the president, Yanukovych. And they ask, you mean the one that's killing us? And he says, that's not what they told me. And they say, if you were asked to jump off a building for the president, would you do that? And he kind of doesn't say anything. It's a real short video, but it's crazy.
That is crazy. I mean, just blind faith. You know, or blind following, I guess.
You also sympathize with his plight. I don't, you know, he's now in the hands of the hostile protesters.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that for him, but, you know, I can't I can't comment on that. Let's see. All we hear about is what's happening. All we hear about is what's happening in Kiev. How far outside of Kiev are the protests spreading, and are you seeing or hearing about large-scale protests in other cities, and what is happening in other locations?
Yeah, there was I think in mid-January. Okay, so in Ukraine, the states are called oblasts, and I'm going to embarrass myself by not knowing the exact number. I think there's about 25 oblasts in Ukraine. And there was a day last month when it felt like victory for the protesters, when it, like, all at once, about half the oblast centers in the country were overrun by protesters. It was an amazing thing. This was still when it didn't get real crazy. At the time, there were about 5 people killed. And in the past 2 days, there have been 70 people killed. So that happened last month. And then in the last week, more government buildings have been overrun. Here in my city, which, you know, it's like 99% support of the protesters, 2 police stations were overrun. The prosecutor's office was overrun. All the records, they thought the prosecutor was collecting, you know, information on who the protesters were. So they threw all the file cabinets outside the prosecutor's office and burned all the documents. The military barracks was overrun.
Jeez.
There was a resupply yesterday, or there were supposed to be reinforcements yesterday from the eastern Russian-speaking city of Dnipropetrovsk. A brigade of paratroopers was supposed to reinforce Kiev. And in that eastern city of Dnipropetrovsk, people blockaded the roads. They felled trees on the roads, and they did all kinds of stuff to prevent that that reinforcements from arriving. And amazingly, they succeeded, and that brigade of paratroopers never deployed to Kiev.
Well,
having
done.
Been a paratrooper in the 82nd Airborne Division, I cannot imagine that happening. But I think the soldiers here are a lot less motivated, especially if they've been tuning into YouTube.
Well, I mean, I think that the American soldiers would, I would like to think that they would do the same. You know, I don't know. You were in the 82nd.
Yes.
And
yes.
So you would be able to speak better to that than myself, because I've never served in the military.
There are reports of soldiers refusing to confiscate weapons during Katrina, which really warmed my heart. And I don't know how much the what's that movement, the Oath Keepers.
Yes.
I don't know how much leverage they have. I certainly hope it's a lot.
I actually have gotten into the habit of asking soldiers that I see on the street if they are an Oath Keeper, and surprisingly, most, if not all, have replied yes. And they know exactly what I'm talking about. That's the part that I really like, is they know.
That's amazing.
They know exactly what I'm talking about.
Although I do think the military is really good at vetting people for loyalty and building special units that would obey. And I think
absolutely.
The recent purge of generals might have had a lot to do with vetting the upper levels of command for loyalty, for blind loyalty to the administration, which is a bit terrifying.
Yes, well, I mean, they're brown shirts throughout history, and there always will be, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, and let's see.
Well, if it comes time to get out of the U.S., you know, feel free. You have an open invitation to come to Lviv.
Well, thank you. are the protesters armed? And if so, what type of armament, aside from the Molotov cocktails, do they have?
Right. So, these protests, they began in November. Most people forget that.
Wow.
And they escalated so slowly. For 2 months, it was people just standing in the streets singing the national anthem and waving flags. And then it was stones and barricades and Molotov cocktails. And now there are guns. I know that about 13 police officers have been killed. I don't know what types of guns the protesters are using. I do know that there are two classes of guns, which I'd never really considered guns until I came to Ukraine. But the first class of guns was compressed air power guns. The second class are called traumatic guns, and they're guns that are modified to only fire like rubber pellets. And for the last 20 years since independence, those are the only two types of guns that non-military, non-police have been able to acquire. The compressed air power guns and the rubber bullet only guns. I don't know what the protesters are using. I do know that those types of guns are very widespread. And I also know that 13 police have been killed, although I don't know how they've been killed, whether it was burned or beaten or shot.
So, but the citizens are not armed like they are here in the States.
No, and that's why they have to go out and fight, in my opinion.
Yeah, exactly. That's a big part of it. That's
yeah.
It's a little easier to control people when they aren't armed.
Right.
And from your perspective, where do you see this thing heading? Where are we going from here?
Where are we going, or where do I want it to go?
Well, the reality.
There's actually a tentative peace deal announced today, just hours ago.
Wow. Okay.
And it's gonna involve a rollback of presidential powers. The backstory to presidential powers is this: when the Orange Revolution happened in 2004, and the non-Russian guy became president, they were like, we need to scale back presidential powers. So presidential powers were scaled way back. And then when the villain of the Orange Revolution arose again and became president, they're like, we can restore presidential powers. So that they were restored in 2010. So the tentative peace deal that's being discussed right now is going to roll back the presidential powers again and create immediate elections. So I think the most likely outcome is one of the opposition candidates will become president, probably Vitali Klitschko. I think that will be an improvement, but kind of a like a lost opportunity too, because Ukraine, as it always is in history, is kind of between two civilizations. In history, they allied with the Turks to sack Moscow way back in like the 16th or 15th century. They made a treaty with the Moscow to fight the Poles. They allied with the Poles to fight the Turks. That's the story of Ukraine. It's just like cutting a deal with one civilization to fight the other. And that's where Ukraine is today, between Europe and between Brussels and Moscow. And I feel like both the tyrants in Moscow and the aspiring tyrants in Brussels want to keep Ukraine's bloated, overgrown, ineffective, corrupt bureaucracy intact so they can just put their man on top.
Right.
The best thing for Ukraine would be, demolishing that centralized system and coming up with either local solutions or private solutions to all the problems that the government is now pretending to solve. But I think what's going to happen is a new president. I think things will get a little bit better. I think ties with the EU will be closer, and that will be an improvement. But it's kind of also a missed opportunity from my perspective.
Now, the person that you mentioned, is he one of the clowns that Victoria Nuland made reference to?
Yeah, so there are three opposition candidates. There's a very uncharismatic guy called Yatsenyuk, a former lawyer, kind of a shadowy background. Nobody really knows where he came from. That's one. Number two is the nationalist firebrand Oleg Chakhnebok. 2 years ago, when I first arrived in Ukraine, he and the nationalist Svoboda Party had very little standing. Most people believe that they were supported by Yanukovych, by the Party of Regions, by the Russians, in order to radicalize the opposition. That was when I arrived 2 years ago. However, they do a lot of very public and effective like protests and demonstrations, so their standing has gone up in the last 2 years. However, the protesters don't support any of these, don't support him or Yatsenyuk. And the third guy is Vladimir Klitschko, who has the most respect because he's a heavyweight boxing champion. He's at least courageous, genuinely. he's probably the most liked, but when he went to go talk to the protesters last month, they sprayed him in the face with a fire extinguisher. Some internet mimes portraying the three as clowns. However, I think after all the violence, I think the protesters will settle for snap elections in exchange for giving up the protests, and that will probably lead to one of these three coming to power. And tragically, the preservation of this horrible, centralized, corrupt, ineffective bureaucracy.
Well, the reason I refer to them as clowns is because they were, CIA operatives that this person was... they were trying to sneak in the back door or in the front door, however you want to look at it,
Yes.
It was just one of the people that they, not that any of the folks that you're talking about would be. I mean, I don't know. I don't know the local politics and I don't pretend to. So I just am going by some of the reports that I've read and the interviews that I've listened to. Well, is there anything that we need to know that you feel is important that may be overlooked at this point as far as some of the reporting? I think you've done a great job in bringing us up to speed into some of what's actually happening on the ground and the reality of it. And I really appreciate that. But if there's anything that we need to know at this point, I mean, you said that there was a peace deal on the table just hours ago. So
right.
That's breaking news. And if there's anything like that, please share, or you feel that's just that you feel is important.
Sure. Well, I guess, two other, I guess just two pieces of analysis are kind of generally being missed. There's a number of reporters probably feeling very smart because they post maps of how Ukraine voted in the last election, and you see a split between people who voted for the Yanukovych and people who voted for you know, the opposition. But it's not a struggle between Ukraine's Russian population and Ukraine's Ukrainian population. It's a struggle between the government and Ukraine and the Ukrainian population with some sympathy from the Russian population. So it's not really a civil war. It's still the people against the government. There are no counter demonstrations. There was recently an interview of a Crimean politician, Russian, yes. A Russian guy in Crimea. And it was an interview on some Russian news agency, and they thought he was anti-protest and pro Yanukovych, but he started talking about how the political class keeps stealing land in Crimea, stealing this beautiful beachside land on the Black Sea. So they cut off the interview mid-sentence and put an end to that. So it's not a civil war. It's not one part of Ukraine against the other. It's one part of Ukraine against the government with some mixed sympathy from the other part of Ukraine. That's one thing. And the other bit of analysis that I feel has been missed, especially in our libertarian circles, is the enemy of your enemy is not your friend. Putin, he's doing a lot of propaganda here, just as the United States is. I agree with Ron Paul's analysis that America should stay out of it, but by staying out of it, I would include not parroting Kremlin propaganda without at least a little bit of thought and analysis.
Thank you. That was part of what you and I discussed yesterday, and I really appreciate you bringing that up, especially the enemy of my enemy is my friend, and he's not. I mean, and I, yes. when we were talking about that, I commented that, you know, Putin is like the best looking mayor at the slaughterhouse. I mean, it's still, you know, or the only one seemingly speaking with the same voice in a room full of insane people. You know, it's who do you listen to? You know, who's telling the truth, or who's getting the closest to the truth? You know, I mean, they're all liars, in my opinion. I mean, if they're a politician, they're probably lying. So, but that's
I met a really interesting guy at a libertarian conference here in Lviv, Yaroslav Romanchuk. He was a former presidential candidate in Belarus. It is a very dangerous thing to be a presidential candidate in Belarus. But we were joking about Russia Today, the Russian news station. We were talking about how great it is in the United States, and it would be like the perfect joke if the United States sponsored a Russian language libertarian news station in Russia, because Russia is sponsoring a libertarian news station in English in America. It's like the Peloponnesian War, when Athens and Sparta, they both did so well because each would free the other's slaves. I think that's what's going on. Russia, seen from Russia as a counterculture to America, is awesome. Russia up close and personal is a lot less awesome. And you know, come see for yourself if you don't believe me.
Well, maybe we will do that. And on that note, I would like to thank you for your time and point people in the direction of your website once again.
Roman's Book Report and the YouTube channel. Oh, the YouTube channel, Roman's Book Report, and RomanInUkraine.com.
Okay. And I'd like to ask if I can stay in touch with you, and I will be following your website and keeping up with your reports out of there. And I will get this posted as soon as possible, because I feel like it's very timely. And I really appreciate your time, Roman. And I guess I'll just talk with you soon.
All right. Thanks for the opportunity. Have a good one.